Ah, ballin', ballin' at what cost? Yeah.
You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I wanna hold you so much. At long last, love has arrived, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. In the way that I stare, there's nothing else to compare. The sight of you leaves a wound. There are no words left to speak. But if you feel like I feel, please let me know that it's real. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you.
Lions, Ravens, Super Bowl. Can't take my eyes off of you, man. But before that, conference championships. We made it. Ballin'. Walk off. We made it.
I love you, baby. And if it's quite alright, I need you, baby, to warm a lovely night. I love you, baby. Trust in me when I say, oh, pretty baby, don't bring me down, I pray. Oh, pretty baby, now that I found you, stay. Let me love you, baby. Let me love you. Just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. You'd be like heaven to touch. I want to hold you so much, Detroit, please. I was long as alive, and I thank God I'm alive. You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you.
Oh my God.
Chiefs have made it to the championships of the conference, so I love you, baby. And if it's quite alright, I need you, baby, to warm a lovely night. I love you, baby. Trust in me when I say,
Lamar, I love you.
Oh, pretty baby, don't bring me down, I pray. Oh, pretty baby, now that I found you, stay. Oh, pretty baby, trust in me when I say, I'd do anything for a Super Bowl with Lamar Jackson and Jared Goff going against each other. But before that,
hi, I'm Rex Apukanikin, and we're balling today, tomorrow, and most definitely yesterday. At what cost? The golden ticket is right in front of our eyes, ladies and gentlemen. The golden ticket is right there. And we went through four matchups last weekend to get to the two this weekend. Ladies and gentlemen, it has been officially 21 weeks straight of NFL football, and that's coming to an end after this weekend. After this weekend, we're going to take a little break, do a little Pro Bowl, have a little bit of fun flag football, recover a little bit, and then the Super Bowl starts and kicks off. So we're working with a schedule here. Okay. Even though you're thinking, okay, all right, what do you mean? If we're going to take a week off, then what do you mean? So listen, today I'm going on a ski trip. We're going to get some nice, crispy winter content, seasonal winter content filmed up in that motherfucker. Gonna get some crisp shots, and then we're gonna come back. We're gonna do a little work, and then we're gonna film another podcast that is not related to Ballin' at What Cost, just to give you a little tease. And then we're gonna come back for the Super Bowl Ballin' at What Cost episode. But to get there and to understand how we're gonna be able to get to that point, we need to recap what happened last weekend. All right, let's get down to the deciders on the AFC side. Straight off the ringer, the Houston Texans, the young team that is formed there, go against the Ravens that is more than experienced. And it's the AFC North versus the AFC South matchup. Ravens come in as the favorites, and they show off their brilliancy. Ravens are one of the few teams that when they need to shine, they really have shined. I think most of the other teams, at least that made it to the divisional round, they are the teams that are like, they could pull it off, they could pull off the big win, right? But it's like they don't dominate in the clutch, you know. This Ravens team is dominating in the clutch, and that is what's scary. But I'm not even gonna get too deep into what the Ravens are capable of. However, the score ended up being 34-10. Everyone on the Ravens absolutely on pitch point. Perfect. Just bam, 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 coordinating, you know, like The Wire, you know, like Stringer Bell was the head coach or something, you know what I'm saying? Running the fucking operation and shit. I don't know if that's racist or not, but fucking, like, you know what I'm saying? That's some real shit right there. And CJ Stroud, the rook, impressive rookie season. He's won the offensive rookie of the season for sure. Yes, they scored 10 points, yes, but there is just so many more points where the Texans can obviously put more talent there. That's the thing. Ravens got a certain amount of talent when it comes to what they're working with. And Texans, they're still young, but you know, they could just develop it further, pick up a couple like vets maybe that are really reliable, and bam, you got an actual Super Bowl caliber team in a couple of years. But Ravens, they do what they do. Moving on to the next one, the second matchup of the Saturday night, it was the 49ers going against the Packers. Moving on to the NFC side, and that was the NFC North versus the West. This one goes down to the wire. This one actually does Packers impressive with their abilities of making offensive plays, but at the same time, you know, making the defensive plays. It's yin and fucking yang. It's feng shui. It's gotta be fucking balanced, you know? Like you're on one of those tight ropes and shit from one tower to the other. You gotta be balanced, okay? Packers, surprisingly balanced, but they couldn't pull off the offensive efficiency. Their defense was trying their best to combat their 49ers offense, but the 49ers offense right now in the postseason are really coming into form. And no matter how well your defense plays, at a certain point, bam, 49ers are going to be able to make the play to take the lead. 49ers beat the Packers, kick the Packers out into the offseason, 24-21. 49ers also hot also hot right now, arguably, possibly, hypothetically, could make it there. Could. Possibly, there is a chance. But, the Lions. Eminem's team. Ninja's team. That Fortnite guy. You know, I was like, yeah. versus the Buccaneers. That's like Bert Kreischer. Buccaneers got everyone. And I got to respect Buccaneers for, you know, what they did with Tom Brady and Gronk that year. However, their third season since winning the Super Bowl and with Baker Mayfield as the quarterback, they still managed to make the playoffs this season, changing around quarterbacks. And Baker Mayfield tried his best. I gotta hand it to him. There was this one running throw that he made with the toe tap out the sideline. It was pure magic. You could see the brilliancy. But I have to say, you gotta give it to the Lions defense too. The Lions defense is known to be rather aggressive, dude. It's like, bro, chill down a little, you know? But Dan Campbell, Jared Goff, all those guys, I'll name names later. The Lions get it done too. Okay, Ford Field, I think it was. Ford Field was on fire that night. And they beat them by 31-23. So it was a back and forth game. However, there was just at one point, Bucks couldn't make the play and the Lions took advantage of it with an extra touchdown. So that's the name of that matchup. Still, Bucks had a very similar season to the Packers. 9-8 throughout the regular season and barely made the playoffs. However, just still, shout out to them, man. To make it this far to the divisional round, really, like Packers and Buccaneers, out of all the other teams that are known to be strong, you know. Same for the Texans. Texans never expected, because these three teams that I mentioned so far that have lost, just the most respect for these three teams, because these three teams were the teams that I would have never guessed would have made the playoffs. So shout out to them, and let alone they made it to the divisional round. So, wow, congrats to those gentlemen and the teams as well. I really think it's a bit of a shame, but you still got to pat yourself on the back, and because now there's a good basis to improve on, hopefully. Ah, that's beautiful too, you know, when you get your coffee just right in the morning. That's a thing of beauty here. But last matchup of the divisional round, we move back to the AFC side. It's the AFC West versus the AFC East. And Patrick Mahomes has been to the divisional round before, but guess what? Patrick Mahomes has never played a playoff game in the enemy territory. This was his first time playing in enemy territory, ladies and gentlemen. They were playing in Buffalo, New York. The Bills, scorching hot, I think, had the longest winning streak, like just overall, carried in through from the regular season. They finally got everything put together. It seemed like the defense was strong again, even though they dealt with the injuries early on in the regular season. I thought they adapted well enough. And it was, the story was, they were adapted well enough. They I'm gonna the whole plot was that they're on par, you know, especially against a team like the Chiefs as well. The Chiefs has had a similar storyline of struggling a little bit, slipping a little too much when they shouldn't have been slipping. And but of course, Patrick Mahomes is still Patrick Mahomes, and he's been struggling too. Like, I wouldn't even consider Travis Kelce necessarily a star player this season, but of course he's still been effective, done his duty, but he's also been struggling with some minor injuries that has been carried out from earlier throughout his career. So there was so much of like the pros and cons equaling out, and that whole situation, it went down to the freaking wire. 44 yards out, Bass has a chance to tie it into overtime, kicks it far right, and I ain't talking about the political fucking term. I'm not talking about Nazis. I ain't talking about Mussolini. I'm talking about the bar went far right, man. Wide right, man. Damn, man. Ooh. Good games, ladies and gentlemen. Good games. Jason Kelce, Taylor Swift still took the fucking, god damn it, they fucking took the goddamn shine from the game. You know, it was a fantastic game. No, I'm not. Football fans were obviously still watching the game as closely as possible. It went down to the wire, man. Stephon Diggs, they say that he dropped a crucial catch, but then again, it's like, yeah, but if they would have made the field goal, they would have been gone into OT, and then you don't know what happens in OT if the Bills win a coin flip or something. So if you take that into consideration, ladies and gentlemen, it was just a tight game. Josh Allen, being the sportsman that he is, before he entered the tunnel, he was finding Bass and he gave him a hug, and he, like, you know, I don't know what he said, but, you know, it was like, you know, just like a show of appreciation. And that's what it is, man. That's sports. The wind was, hey, there was wind in Buffalo. That's all I'm going to say. There was wind. You can't deny there wasn't wind. I'm not going to say it was a tornado amount of wind, but there was a little bit of wind. But anyways, Chiefs, congratulations once again into the AFC championships. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, we've made it to the freaking conference championships. We've made conference, and this is important. It took me a while to realize how important the conference championships actually are, because the way that the NFL matchups are designed, the home games are more, there's more home games, or like, no, there's more games within your conference, and then at the same time, there's more emphasis on those, you know, like AFC matchups or like own division matchups. So with that in mind, you're really just seeing what's the best team from both sides. You really are. And with this, then you kind of see, after this, then you see, okay, who's the best team. But also, you get to see who's the best team on a certain side. Because one side, for example, AFC, was a much more bigger shit show going into the playoff picture than NFC was. NFC was clearly like, there was good. There was a little bit of mixy stuff going on in that NFC. I'm not denying that, but still, the AFC was far more competitive. So you could then see, like, okay, well, who's the best out of the AFC? Ravens versus Patrick Mahomes. I mean, sorry, the Chiefs. Sorry, I apologize. Ravens versus the Chiefs. They go against each other. Ravens So Patrick Mahomes has been here before, and the Ravens, they haven't been there before yet with Lamar Jackson Jr., and now they're finally going against each other for the decider, too. Patrick Mahomes and Lamar Jackson Jr. haven't gone against each other in the championships yet, and this is what's about to be insane. In the NFC Championship, it's the Lions versus the 49ers, man. As simple as that. But let's start it off with the 49ers. I'll get you in a little deep dive. So, San Francisco 49ers. Brock Purdy is the all-time single-season passing leader in 49ers history. 31 touchdowns this season. And, ladies and gentlemen, in the 2022 NFL draft, we're in the 2024 now, so 2 years ago, he was the 7th round, 262nd overall pick of the NFL draft. 7th round, 262. And now he has a shot, and a very solid shot, at making it into the Super Bowl. I want people to understand the absolute just effectiveness of Brock Purdy. It seems like he came into the league, got drafted, and he did exactly what he had to do. And now he's in a position where, hey, kid, you're more than earned this spot. So yeah, go ahead and start the games. More than happy to. Kyle Shanahan, a rather legendary coach, but he has been offensive coordinator / head coach for many, many years with the 49ers. And now he's been only the head coach. But you can imagine he's from like more of an offensive standpoint. However, their defensive coach is like the best ever or some shit. And the team this season, they've scored on teams 491 points, which is an average of 289 per game. And that's the third best stat out of 32 teams in the league. And they've been scored on 298 points, which is a 17.5 point average per game. And that's also the third of 32 teams of the NFL, which is absolutely insane. So they're so level on both. They're both on the same exact level in terms of the league, in comparison to the league, when it comes to their offense and defense. Their ability or level is the same. Do you understand how absolutely statistical insane that is? Like, I feel like this is what Albert Einstein felt like when he, you know, discovered whatever, you know, theory of physics or whatever, you know, that he whatever that was, like E equals MC squared, right? Or this is how Stephen Hawking felt when those, you know, underage girls, you know, freaking like jerked him off while he was like typing on the keyboard on the Jeffrey Epstein Island. That's how I feel like dropping these stats. Straight up. Because this is insane. This is insane. I've never heard of stuff like this. The star players. Offense. Brandon Ayuk. Deebo Samuel. Christian McCaffrey. George Kittle. Kyle Juszczyk. Right? And then we go on to the defense. Fred Warner. Linebacker, first team All-Pro. Charvarius Ward, cornerback. Nick Bosa, defensive lineman, highest paid defensive player contract right now. Javon Hargrave, defensive lineman. This team is so stacked in their potential of performance from the offense and the defense. It's it blows my mind. And now they're going to go against the Detroit Lions, on the other hand. The Detroit Lions offense is led by Jared Goff. He was drafted by the Los Angeles Rams in the first round, first overall in 2016. 4 seasons in the top 10 of passing touchdown quarterbacks. 6 seasons in the top 10 for passing yards per game. Super Bowl caliber baller that deserves a ring. Because he's made it there before. The first Super Bowl that I ever watched was Jared Goff making it to the Super Bowl against the New England Patriots in what has to be the most boring game of NFL I've ever seen in my life. And somehow after that, I still decided to come back. That just goes to show how fucking retarded I am, right? And so keep that in mind. He's the first round, first overall. So we're going around against first round, first overall, and seventh round, 262nd overall. To put a little perspective, Brock Purdy been around for a couple seasons. Jared Goff been around for a little more than that. All right, Dan Campbell, think former tight end of the NFL. He's the head coach now of the Detroit Lions. He's been impressive. He's been there since 2021, and he's turned the team around from starting at 3-something, and then last season they were 9-8, and then this season they are 12-6 or some shit like that, like 12-5, like a bunch of doctors. And for reals, they've been also on par with everything in terms of the ability of their team. 0 appearances in the Super Bowl, despite being an organization before the Super Bowl era. So they've been there every single year of the Super Bowl era, and they have 0 appearances, not even wins, just appearances. And 1991 was the last time they had won a playoff game, right? So that's why they're already like pretty proud of themselves. And I'm gonna drop the same stats. They've scored a total of 461 points so far, which is, or I think this is the regular season, my bad, and which is 27.1 points per game on average, which is the fifth out of 32 teams in the NFL. However, they've been scored on 295 points, which is the 23.2 points per game on average, which is the 23rd out of 32. So, despite the fact that they're fifth in the league on scoring points, they're 23rd in the team when it comes to getting scored on. So this means the Detroit Lions can only defeat the 49ers if the defensive star players like Aiden Hutchinson, the defensive lineman, and Jalen Reeves-Maybin, the linebacker, to name a few. If these boys, men, sorry, could make the big plays against the 49ers, stuff them out, make the reads. The Lions need an interception, man. That's the thing. The Lions need to make a big defensive play if they want to battle out people. You got to stop people like Deebo Samuel, Christian McCaffrey, George Kittle. That's a fact. And the best way to stop, you got to read them, man. You got to be confident. Brock Purdy, you got to put him on pressure, man. Put him on pressure. The defense got to think like, yeah, this motherfucker 262 overall, dude. Some of those defensive players are probably even drafted higher than that quarterback, you know. So that's the way they got to think. They got to think a little bit more animalistic, a little bit more aggressive, because that's the only way they're going to be able to battle out championship players like that. But on the offense for the Lions, Penei Sewell, the tackle, Frank Ragnow, the center, they've always been on point with Jared Goff. They've done a very good job at protecting Jared Goff. And Jahmyr Gibbs, the rookie running back, I think set a couple records this season so far. David Montgomery, the other running back, and Amon-Ra St. Brown, their main wide receiver. These boys, I'm not going to doubt them. I think they're always going to be on point. Like I said, fifth out of 32. However, there's an urgency on the defense. All right. So with that being said, on the NFC Championship, I predict the Lions win an OT. Lions win an OT. Lions win an OT. That's what I'm predicting. I'm sorry. No, Tony Montana. Tony Montana. Tony Montana. Tony Montana. Get the put the boys. None of that this year. I'm sorry. I'm sorry, future. I'm sorry. All right, we got to move on, okay? AFC Championship. Wow. Oh my goodness. Okay, fine. Here we go. The meat riding is insane, dude. Patrick Mahomes, drafted by the Kansas City Chiefs in the first round and 10th overall in 2017 draft. Career 96 games played, with 74 wins and 22 losses. That's his career record. Number one passes completed this season, and he also has the number one in attempts as well. Has always been in the top 10 in passing touchdowns since entering the league. And this unstoppable force has been acknowledged before. Kansas City Chiefs and Patrick Mahomes, we understand their ability. It's kind of like up until last season with the Golden State Warriors. I get it. You guys are always kind of just going to be lurking around. And Patrick Mahomes, the number one reason why they aren't on the tip-top form that they used to is because they've been struggling with the wide receiving position, right? But Patrick Mahomes, he's got the balls of steel. He still can make the plays, and Andy Reid calling like he does it. He's been slinging it out still as much as possible, and there still has been someone receiving the ball on the other end. So, Patrick Mahomes, he's an absolute legend since coming into the league. Andy Reid has been the number one reason why he's been an unstoppable force. Both of them are, I would argue, the modern era fucking Brady, Belichick. That's it. I would say so. And Andy Reid, is the winningest coach of Kansas City Chiefs history. And he's been there for a long, long time. And this is another attempt to go back-to-back Super Bowl championships. That's how spoiled the Kansas City Chiefs fans are. But this is the fact. They've already made made the Super Bowl three times since 2019. And this is their another try going back to back. They've never gone back to back. They've won and then lost, but they've never gone back to back. So they get to go for it again. And here we go. Here's some stats for you. Back on the stats. They've scored 371 points this season against teams, which is on average 21.8 points per game, which is the 15th out of 32 teams in the NFL. On the other hand, on the flip side, they've been scored on 294 points, which is on average 17.3 points per game, which is the second out of 32 teams. So, this is the analysis. They can't score big points. And yeah, if you look at the Chiefs' schedule throughout the whole season, the regular season, you don't see high scoring games because there's not that. They haven't been deep balling to Travis Kelce at all this season. And they don't have a guy like Tyreek Hill that could just always go for deep balls. They barely go for deep balls. Every now and then they get, I'd say, like a 30-yard throw or something like that. But otherwise, it's not that common. So with that, they're only the 15th. They go against a team that is known for scoring quite a lot. However, they know how to prevent teams from scoring. And they do it the second best in the whole league. They just play effective defense, and they don't let you score too much. And the people that help out with that job is players like Trent McDuffie, cornerback, and Chris Jones, defensive tackle. These guys are making the big plays. So, you know, okay, yeah, maybe Patrick Mahomes, he's struggling with his wide receivers a little bit, and Pacheco can't get it effective, and Kelce is, he can't get open, and okay, maybe that doesn't go well. So then what happens is, bam, you just let the defense make the play. However, there is still more than enough talent on the offensive side with Creed Humphrey, Rashee Rice, Isaiah Pacheco, Jerick McKinnon, Travis Kelce. These guys have been helping Patrick Mahomes. And, you know, for me, my perspective is it's just not the same when you're not playing Kelce and then Tyreek Hill isn't there. It just is. It doesn't hit the same, you know. Yeah, Mahomes magic, but you haven't, like, Mahomes magic was being able to just sling it out constantly to Kelce and, you know, Tyreek Hill. You know, now he's had to play, I really feel like he's had to play on his back foot a little bit throughout the whole season. And at the same time, I think Patrick Mahomes just might be the one athlete out there that likes to play on his back foot. Fuck it. Put me in a corner. I'll shine, motherfucker. I'll break out of there. So, you know, I'm never going to doubt Patrick Mahomes. But the gentleman that he's going up against now, they are a force to be reckoned with. And arguably, if you look at the outline of the team, quite similar. It just doesn't have as the same accolades. So Lamar Jackson Jr., the leading man of the team, drafted by the Baltimore Ravens in the first round as well. So we have three quarterbacks that are drafted in the first round. And then we have Brock Purdy in the seventh. That's how much you gotta tip Brock Purdy. But anyway, 32nd overall in 2018. So Patrick Mahomes drafted 2017, a year earlier than Lamar Jackson Jr. He comes in 2018, 86 games played, and he has 58 wins and 19 losses. Also ridiculous career record. Like, it sounds very similar ratio-wise to Patrick Mahomes, 74-22. I'm literally going to grab the calculator out because... 74... Or what do we... Wait, how do we... And then 15. Yeah, dude, it's absolutely insane. I don't know what kind of mathematics I did. It was absolutely the wrong one. I don't think I should ever do mathematics again. I should just only plagiarize it. Absolutely. Yeah, no, I chalk that, but. Anyways, the ratio sounds about the same. You know, it's absolutely insane. I know actually Patrick Mahomes is a little bit more impressive because he has three more losses. However, he has what is it again? He has 74 and then 58 16. Damn, he has 16 more wins and 3 more losses. Okay, that is much more insane. But still, however, 58 wins with 19 losses is pretty damn impressive still, right? That's pretty much almost like 2/3 win rate. Yeah. Yeah, that's almost 70% win rate. Okay, no, that's math right there. That was actually right. That was actually statistically right. But anyway, holy shit, I feel so smart right now. He had a little bit of, let's just say a little bit of off-field drama last year. He was trying to guarantee himself the paycheck that he felt he deserved with the talent and the abilities that he provides on-field, in-game. And after negotiations with the Baltimore Ravens, he was able to secure the 5-year, $260 million, $185 million guaranteed of that, which has come into fruition because here we are in the conference championships. And I think this is the best him and his team have looked since 2019, which was his kind of like breakout year, where he broke all the records and just they had a very good record. Unfortunately, just lost it in the playoffs, and now he's motivated by that extra. Look, come on, 185 mil, but think about it with, you know, just a little bit. Little bit of tweakage, you can get 75 mil more. So let's just, he's gonna want to do everything in his power to be able to get that rest of the 260 mil. But moving on to the head coach, John Harbaugh, legendary coach. His brother is also a legendary coach, but he's the winningest coach of the Ravens history and has a ring already from 2013 where him and Joe Flacco were able to win the Super Bowl. However, he's been with the Ravens and hasn't been able to reach such accolades so far with new rosters since 2013. And here we go. They've scored 483 points on teams during the regular season, and that's an average of 28.4 points per game, which is the fourth out of 32 teams in the league, and they've let teams score a total of 280 points, which is an average of 16.5 points per game. Sorry, it trips me out a little bit. Which is, drumroll please, the first in the all of the teams in the NFL. So basically, their defense is flawless. Or if not flawless, it's the strongest. If you want a opportunity to score, guess what? It's gonna be really gritty to score, and that's going against a team that's not strong at scoring. You know, I'm trying to put the math together here, and they're still fourth when it comes to scoring points. And I know, yes, the defense was the second, right? The Chiefs defense was the second out of 32 teams. However, just think about the fact that they can still score. And I don't even think that Lamar Jackson Jr. has like played insane yet. And now I really do think he knows that his defense at least is at the strongest with players like Roquan Smith, the linebacker, Kyle Hamilton, the safety, and Justin Madubuike, which is the defensive tackle, right? They will put on a hell of a pressure on Patrick Mahomes this upcoming weekend. I know that for sure. And also on the offense, you have Tyler Lindebaum, the center, which has been helping out Lamar Jackson Jr. beautifully. Gus Edwards, the running back. Zay Flowers, Mark Andrews, Justice Hill, who's also a running back. Mark Andrews finally back as well, you know. And I think he's going to be a huge difference maker, because Mark Andrews, arguably one of the best tight ends, just been out for some of the games this season so far. So with this being said, I think the Ravens are just going to handle Chiefs, man. I think the fact that the defense is so strong, and the Chiefs offense has been known for not being super effective throughout the regular season and up until now. So I'm predicting a Ravens-Lions Super Bowl. I might have already said it before, all the way up in the beginning. However, that's the Super Bowl that America wants right now and the world wants right now. I'll do anything to avoid another Chiefs 49ers Super Bowl. I've seen it before. I'm not trying to be like, you know, negative. I've seen the matchup before, you know, with the same-ish players. I want variety. I'm sorry. I like change-ups. I like a little switcheroo. So I think the most likely outcome is maybe Ravens versus 49ers, as they look the most refined. However, I do think Campbell is, with the mentality that he brings as a head coach into the locker room, it's that's going to take him to the Super Bowl. And I think either way, all the teams are so talented that all the matchups are going to be dependent on the big plays, the individual plays, the game-shifting plays, the one deep ball or the one huge run where you break the tackle and you gain not even all the way, or the one interception or the one pick six or or the one fumble, something in that vicinity, because I think that's really, I think these are going to be close games either way. I don't see a shot. The only way is maybe if the Ravens defense absolutely destroys the Chiefs offense. But I still do think that everyone's pretty much on par. Brock Purdy can fuck with all those first rounders all he wants. And that's the confidence he has. I'm wearing the legendary Boston Celtics 33, Larry Bird. And that's just to point out for the Ravens, man, the Bird, you know. I'm supporting the Ravens, I'm supporting the Lions, but either way, just excited for the highest level of competition, because after when you get to the Super Bowl, it's more, I really do think it's more of a show. Of course you watch the game, of course you want to see who's the best, but that's still like, there's a whole thing of the Super Bowl. Now it's still like the last moment where it's just purely competition. So here we go, man. Conference championships this weekend on Sunday night. Both games. The first game, it's gonna be Chiefs versus the Ravens, and then it's gonna be followed by 49ers versus the Lions. With that being said, ladies and gentlemen, let's just recap real quick. And I want to drop a little geographical fucking info dot on you. And oh, before we get into that, shout out to profootballreference.com. That's where I got all my statistics from, and everything. So that's how I'm citing them. Shout out to them. I got all the stats from there. Really great website for like the craziest amount of stats and all kind of stats that you want to look for. So go there if you want to check out some stats. I was nerding out yesterday and obviously right now, and it's been a great fun. Let's move on to a little bit of geographical information, because in case you didn't know, Canada doesn't exist. The UFC equals the North America. UFC equals North America. That's it. So the UFC is America, and America is red, white, and blue. Freedom, baby. Nothing but freedom, okay? Canadians were getting destroyed. We were in Toronto for the UFC 297. And, yeah, lots of Canadian fighters throughout the whole night, even in the main card. And the Canadians were destroyed. I think there was, 8 Canadian fighters, 2 fighters won, Canadian fighters won, but they were only the females. None of the male Canadian fighters won. A couple of them honestly got pretty destroyed at home, which is a little bit, but like, you know, it was like, people were cheering from the Americans almost. It's crazy. And going into the main event, Sean Strickland defends his middleweight title against Dricus du Plessis. And they go the distance into a split decision. The decision goes to Dricus du Plessis, new middleweight champion of the world. And Sean Strickland has made multiple claims already that he has won the fight. Many other people would argue that he has won the fight. I would argue almost that he had won the fight. But I do see how Dricus du Plessis could have won the fight as well. He was more effective with the touchdowns, and he was keeping the takedowns and the pressure, right? However, you really got to think about the possibility that it was just so close. It was just so darn close. And it could have gone both ways. You really don't know what's what. And at the end of the day, I do think Sean Strickland, there is so much like behind him in terms of the person that he is, that I do think he's going to be getting a title shot at one point somehow anyways. So Sean Strickland, great fight. Both men put it all out on the line. They made it the distance. And, you know, that's 25 minutes of just like trying to fuck each other up. And they were definitely going at it. So shout out to both gentlemen. Hell of a show. And yeah, Sean Strickland. Shout out to Sean Strickland. And yeah, hey, ladies and gentlemen, we've enjoyed the conference championships. This has been a great, great, great NFL streak. I'm not going to call it quits yet.
I'm not going to get emotional, please.
I'm not going to get emotional. I'm going to leave it at that. We'll hit you with a little bit of just like 1 week break. And I'll hit you with the Super Bowl buildup, and then we'll see about that later, all right? It's been a pleasure. I'm going on a ski trip. I'll be back. I'll film some content there. I'll edit it. There's some new stuff coming. I'm real hyped. But ladies and gentlemen, I will see you.
Slow down, you crazy child. You're so ambitious for a juvenile. But then if you're so smart, tell me why are you still so afraid? Where's the fire? What's the hurry about? You better cool it off before you burn it out. You got so much to do and only so many hours in a day. But you know that when the truth is told, that you can get what you want, or you can just get old. You're gonna kick out before you even get halfway through. Ooh, when will you realize
all it's waiting for you?
Slow down, you're doing fine. Can't be everything you wanna be before your time. Although it's so romantic on the borderline tonight. Too bad, but it's the life you lead. You're so ahead of yourself that you forgot what you need. Though you can see when you're wrong, you know you can't always see when you're right. You're right. You got your passion, you got your pride, but don't you know that only fools are satisfied? Dream on, but don't imagine they all come true. Ooh, when will you realize
ballin's waiting for you?
Conference championships. Last step before the Super Bowl. Who's getting the golden ticket?
Wow.
Slow down, crazy child. And take the phone off the hook and disappear for a while. It's alright, you can't afford to lose a day or two. Ooh, when will you realize ball waits for you? When the truth is told, that you can get what you want, or you can just get old. You're gonna kick out before you even get halfway through. Ooh, why don't you realize
ballin' waits for you?
When will you realize
ballin' waits for you?
At what cost? Every day, tomorrow, today, and most definitely, yesterday. Wow. Beautiful. Beautiful. Thank you, Billy. Thank you, Billy Joel. I appreciate that one.